are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I am the Associate Professor of Jazz Studies here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills, and today is the first session of the class entitled Key Movements, the Age of Jazz. Welcome. So, in this class, I'll be teaching out of two books in particular. The first book is called The Jazz Age, Popular Music in the 1920s by Arnold Shaw. So you'll need that book. And then also, the second book is African Americans in the Jazz Age, A Decade of Struggle and Promise by Mark R. Schroeder. During this class, I'm going to cover many different topics. We're going to go from music to historical figures, psychologists, social analysts, composers, poets. We're going to run the gamut of American culture throughout the 1920s. So you will hear, you know, names that are familiar and that are also unfamiliar to you, but that will give you a complete education of what happened in the 1920s during the Jazz Age. We're going to cover different great jazz artists, as I just said. One of those artists is the great Duke Ellington and his Cotton Club Orchestra. And you're going to see Duke Ellington in a second. There he is right there. That club is probably the Cotton Club, as you would think, because the orchestra is called the Cotton Club Orchestra. So, you know, we'll talk about the Cotton Club in Harlem and its significance in bringing such great talent to Harlem to perform. And we'll talk about the different people that went up there to hear those performers. Then we'll go on to Louis Armstrong, or Louis Armstrong. Probably one of the, definitely the premier trumpet voice in American music or in the world. In terms of jazz, everybody wanted to play like Louis Armstrong. And a lot of people are influenced by his singing as well. And such a monumental world figure, you know, in music and entertainment. Very important person. After that, we're going to travel up from down south and talk about the migration of African Americans out of the Jim Crow South starting around 1916. We'll go on to the next photo, and you'll see people who are part of the Great Migration out of the South, packing up, leaving the South for a better life up north. And with that movement, with that migration, came a lot of great music, new perspectives, writers, civil rights activists, feminists, all kinds of different thinkers that changed the landscape of America during that time. We're also going to look at a group of young ladies, or they were pretty young, called the Flappers. And they were the next generation of feminists after the, you know, the big wig feminists in terms of like Susan B. Anthony and people like that. But these were the ladies who benefited from those struggles and gains that Susan B. Anthony and others made. The Flappers were able to reap the benefits, and they lived their lives how they saw fit. So that's a very important group of people right there. And then we're going to look at the New Negro Movement, or the New Negro, and how these leaders and thinkers became the bedrock for the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s. You're going to see right here, this is the New Negro Movement. Change of thinking that transpired in America. It was the beginning of the civil rights era. It was part of the journey into a new way of thinking intellectually about themselves and how they related to society. And you have to remember that that breakaway was during Jim Crow, which the Jim Crow laws were very harsh laws racially. And so the New Negroes were stepping away from that. and saying we want to do something different as a race of people for black people. So then after that, we're going to start looking at different styles of music. Because during this time, you had different types of music that affected the world. Not only did they affect other American styles of music, but these styles that we'll be talking about went out into the world and just totally positively affected the world and how they saw America, American music. One of those styles is the blues. Some of you may know what the blues is, but you definitely have heard it and you've heard its influence in American music. That right there is Robert Johnson playing the guitar. And we'll talk about the different figures, the leading figures of the blues, but then we'll talk about rock and roll and how it was influenced by the blues, how jazz was influenced by the blues. And you look at how important that music is to other styles and to American culture. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about ragtime music and how important it was during the time. That right there is Scott Joplin. Scott Joplin is really one of those figures that was probably one of the most, I don't want to say he was the smartest, but he was definitely one of the trendsetters in thinking in terms of how he ran his business as a musician and a composer. He benefited greatly from the production of music of one of his songs, The Maple Leaf Rag. So he was able to benefit greatly monetarily. He made a lot of money off of what he did. But also the style of music that he played was very advanced for the time. And that style of music ended up influencing many styles of jazz. And it helped create the sheet music publishing industry at the time. So we'll look at ragtime. Then we'll travel on to New York City and we'll study Tin Pan Alley and how important it was not only for composers who were pitching songs, but also in terms of how Tin Pan Alley was, because it housed so many publishers on one street. We'll talk about how those publishers were able to take the songs of different composers and really take that music and make money at it at a whole nother level that the music business had ever seen. It had never happened like that. There were people who were buying music who, you know, they were just regular people who tinkled at the piano, and yet that purchase of music, sheet music, was able to spawn a whole mass amount of music production in terms of it being played and produced for the market to be bought. And that time has affected how we hear and see music mass-produced today. So that's a very important time that we'll talk about, the Tin Pan Alley songs. And then we'll talk about musical theater, which is a very, very important time in American music. We'll talk about the different composers. We'll talk about, right there we see Richard Rodgers, Irving Berlin, and Oscar Hammerstein II. Those are very, very important composers, writers of music. And you can still hear their music today, whether it's inside, the music is used in a play or in commercials, or the influence of that music on songs today that we hear. These people right here did amazing things with music and lyrics. So that's musical theater. And then we'll talk about the great poets and writers of the same time. We'll talk about one of the leading poets of the Harlem Renaissance. His name is Langston Hughes. And you'll see Langston Hughes in a minute. There he is, Langston Hughes. Great poet and leader of the poets, you know, during the Harlem Renaissance. And he's very important because he established not only a very, I don't want to say simple, but adaptable style of poetry that spoke directly to his community that he was from in Harlem and around the country for people who bought his poetry. And also, this is the first person who could make a living 100% from his poetry, from writing the poetry, from writing period, from writing columns, writing, releasing books, all of that. Very important figure. And then after Mr. Langston Hughes, we have another important figure. Her name is Zora Neale Hurston. One of the great, great writers during the Harlem Renaissance. Some people view her as being the leader of the Harlem Renaissance, and some people say Langston Hughes as well, but she's one of the bright voices coming out of the Jim Crow South, heading up north, and making documentaries, and writing books, and just recently in the past 20 years, her books have been developed into films, and the most notable being Their Eyes Were Watching God. And we'll talk about that film as well. But one of the major, major voices of the Harlem Renaissance right there, Zora Neale Hurston. And we'll look at other poets as well. Those are just two of the main ones from that period. Then we'll look at F. Scott Fitzgerald. And you're going to see him right here. And his production, or rather his book, The Great Gatsby, and how important that was to American culture and to the jazz age as the world knows it. And how his book just affected so many people, and how he was a part of the times out in New York and Long Island, and how he and his wife were gallivanting and living it up, but yet writing about it and documenting those times in his book, and how that book shaped so much for the world to read about the jazz age. So he was a very, very important figure as well. On a more mass level, this is someone who wrote a book and millions of people read his book during the time. So he was able to enjoy success during the time of, you know, from which he lived, which not all of these people have had experienced. Some of them received success later. He received it at the time that he wrote his book, his most famous book, The Great Gatsby. And then we're going to travel to the ballrooms of New York City. This is going to be very important because you'll get to see where people were dancing, because they were dancing the big bands. You know, big band music was very popular during this time. You had big bands who were largely responsible for providing the entertainment for nightlife. So you had places, ballrooms, where people would go and they would dance. You know, this was not during the time of smartphones. Everybody's in their smartphone, you know, doing their thing by themselves. This is a time when people would go out and party together. You know, it was more of a communal environment. So the ballrooms, as we're going to see in a second, are the places where they would do different dances, such as the Lindy Hop. Okay, we're going to talk about the Lindy Hop and how important that dance was to Americans who were doing their thing. And this was one of those dances that was like, you know, it was a craze, you know. It was very popular, and everyone did it, and they enjoyed themselves, and the bands facilitated the music so that people could do the dances. Now, you have to understand that during this time, dances gave people identity socially. So dancing was very, very important. Very important. It's not like today where somebody could buy a car and get, you know, kind of buy their identity with their car. You know, during this time, it was more about how you danced, how you dressed, how you carried yourself. And so the Lindy Hop was one of those dances that people did to really get an identity about who they were, and they could show and express themselves through dancing. Then after we talk about the Lindy Hop, we're going to move on to the Charleston. The Charleston was another dance that was extremely popular during that time. And it was one of those dances that was very accessible for most people. They could actually do it. They didn't have to be too athletic. Some dances were really athletic, and some were not. But this was one that was a little more accessible for more
you know, more for people who were not the most athletic dancers, but they could enjoy themselves and be part of the fun and part of the scene. So the Charleston, we'll examine that dance as well. And then we'll move on to this dance called the Black Bottom. The Black Bottom. Yeah, so this is right here. You see a picture of people doing the Black Bottom. Notice the guy playing the piano. Looks like somebody's apartment, maybe. And that's how it was back then. Somebody would just get on the piano, start playing, and people would just dance immediately. Different time. People were more connected as individuals, individual human beings. It was a different type of thing. And they were just more connected to each other. And with that came a very, with that connectiveness or connectedness, you had a lot of rub, right? Socially, you had a lot of rub. People were interacting with each other a lot more. So we'll examine those rubs as well, those moments when people you know, maybe didn't get along and didn't see things the same way, but they struggled to get their point across or their ideology across. We'll talk about that as well. Then we'll move on to the artists. There were some great artists during this time who developed different styles that were extremely identified by the experience that they lived. One of those people is Romare Bearden. Romare Bearden, who was what we call a Harlemite, someone who really represented Harlem, New York, and its real true connectedness to Black culture in a city environment. And the change, I told you about the New Negro, and this man right here represents that change. And what's also important is how he was connected to jazz music and how he was influenced by jazz. You can see right there one of his collages. And what he did was he combined painting with collages, and he would cut out paper, faces and objects from newspapers, and he would combine them with colors and paint his paintbrush and his canvas, and he came up with his own style that was really different from everyone else. So he's one of the leading painters of this time, Romare Bearden. After Romare Bearden, oh, there's another piece right there that's very nice. You can see the face of the person has about maybe four different elements to create a face. Two different eyes, one cheek is white, one cheek is green. And so those different colors are cutouts, sometimes from magazines, sometimes from newspapers. Yeah, and then he would also sometimes paint the cutout. Very, very unique style. An extension of some of the classical people that he studied, but also some of his newer concepts, and he would combine them all to create his own style. You can see the faces. Faces had real character. It wasn't just a smile. Sometimes it was just a glare. So that was a very original style for that time, and it spoke to the world about what Harlem, New York was about. So we'll discover and really examine that. Another painter from the time is Archibald Motley. And you're gonna see his, there's Archibald right there. A man from Chicago who was, you know, a trendsetter in painting as well, and who influenced a whole list of painters in Chicago that are out here now, who, you know, whose work is being showed at major museums in America. So yeah, so you see the shapes. And with Archibald's, you'll see that we don't have collages. We actually have people's faces that he painted. But you get the feel of jazz. You can see the instruments in the background. And you can see the people smiling and looking at each other like a real club, cigarette in hand. You see the musicians in the background. So you see that influence of jazz culture on American culture. There's a street probably in Chicago, and you see the figures walking down the street, moving, city, bustling. We're gonna look at all that
Yeah, see the blue, the blueness in the background. And you can almost see stars in the back if you look in the back. You don't know if that's the sky or if that's the street, right? Could be a street light, could be a star. Yeah, very nice painting. Oh, there's another one. Dancing, so that we're at the dancing hall. And you see a lot of different figures in the dance hall. Regular people, people passing by, people dancing, people watching, somebody's on a bike. You get a feel about real Chicago life from the 20s just by looking at that. The guy with the top hat, playing an accordion, lush colors, expressive facial expressions. Yeah. So we're going to study Archibald Motley as well. And then after him, we're going to talk about different musicians from today that are influenced by the 1920s. So, you know, these will pretty much be jazz artists, blues artists, and even rock artists, because I like to let people know that rock is influenced by blues, because a lot of people don't know that, but yet they like the sound. So, you know, I like to connect it to the blues, because if you dig a little deeper, you might get some other knowledge about music that could, you know, make you feel a little better about listening to live music or listening to music in general, and you might go out and support music in a different type of way. So we'll look at different people from those different styles that are directly influenced by blues, by jazz, and also hip hop. There are some people from this time that were definitely in the same, they had the same way of communicating as hip hop does today. Call and response, telling a story, directly related. So we'll look at some of those people as well. So now we're going to talk about one of the styles of music. We're going to talk about the blues. And so, like I said, some of you have heard the blues, and I'll tell you what it is by definition, because maybe you don't, you know it when you hear it, but you don't know how to talk about it. So here's the definition for the blues. This is important. Write it down. The blues is a secular African-American musical genre which started in the rural areas of the southern United States. Rural just means farm areas of the southern United States. The most influential areas being from the Mississippi Delta region of the United States. So the Delta region is by the Mississippi River. So this is where the most raw expression in the blues came out of. There are other cities as well. There's also, so you have the Mississippi Delta style. You also have the Texas blues style. You have the New Orleans blues style. You have the Memphis blues style. And then you have the Chicago blues style as well. Now, this music, as I said before, has gone on to influence people in various genres of music, including rock, hip-hop, pop, soul, R&B, and, of course, jazz music. Blues songs deal with a variety of topics and emotions, mostly dealing with sorrow and protest. So when I say sorrow and protest, that means sad conditions, right? You don't have any money, you don't have a job, your woman left you. Why is my life so bad? Those are common themes in the blues. And that music is expressed that way so that people feel, after they've listened to the blues and after they've sat in front of an artist, that they can feel better about their life after they sat and listened to the blues. Right? So there's a commonality about in blues music that it speaks directly to the common man and woman. Right? Much in the way hip hop does now. and it speaks. I'm not talking about the, I'm talking about the quality hip hop, not the stuff that is not dealing with that, but music that directly is speaking to the people from that community and expressing its disdain for the conditions that the people are living. That's what blues music does. The earliest blues music was developed as early as the 1890s. Now, you got to remember, this is like maybe 15 years after slavery ended. So that's why the music has that quality to it, that it speaks about conditions, bad conditions, poverty, you know, things like that the people were experiencing and they were talking about and singing about through their music. And the people who were also from those regions, they felt as though they could identify with that music because they were living pretty much in the same conditions. And you have to remember that this music sprung up out of plantations, okay? So even though slavery had ended, what you had was you had people who were working on plantations, baling cotton, tobacco, different things like that, and the hot suns, you know, so in the hot environment, mosquitoes are biting you, you know, you're working long hours from sun up to sundown. And then at the end of the week, you had a little money, had a little change, and you went to the juke joint, as they called it. And the juke joint was where everybody that worked on the farm or the plantation would go to have a good time at the end of the week. And so you have to understand that the people who were listening to the blues artists were the people who worked right on the farm. So that blues artist spoke a language, a life language, that those people could clearly understand and connect with. And so that's why when we start to listen to and when I read through lyrics, you're gonna see how the music has a really, really blue collar work theme to it. And you're gonna understand, or I want you to understand, that it is because these people are working on plantations. They're picking tobacco, cotton, working in that hot sun. At the end of the week, they want to have some drinks and they want to have a get down. A get down, as we call it. A get down. We're going to get down, right? Because I've had a rough week. So then when people go down on Friday, they want to hear it. They want to hear these people play and sing, and they want that music to hit them right in the soul. And that's why when you listen to blues music, you're going to hear a very truthful sounding music that is not music with a lot of ornamentation, a lot of glitz and glamour. It's not about that at all. No bling bling. Okay, this is right to the core about life in the Deep South, in the Mississippi Delta. True music with a real direct message. Okay? So now we're going to listen to some blues. We're going to listen to Robert Johnson, and we're going to listen to a song called Kind Hearted Woman. But before we listen to it, I'm going to read the lyrics to you. These are the lyrics to Kind Hearted Woman. Well, the song is called Kind Hearted Woman Blues. So this guy says, I got a kind hearted woman. Do anything in this world for me. She'll do anything in this world for him. I got a kind-hearted woman. Do anything in this world for me. But these evil-hearted women, man, they will not let me be. He says, I love my baby. My baby don't love me. I love my baby, but my baby don't love me. But I really love that woman, can't stand to leave her be. Ain't but the one thing makes Mr. Johnson drink. As worried about how you treat me, baby, I begin to think, oh baby, my life don't feel the same, you breaks. In other words, you break my heart. So we're going to listen to this song. And what I would like for you to do, if you are familiar with music at all, some of you may actually come from playing an instrument already, or maybe you just listen to music in your leisure so you know how to listen to music. So what we're going to listen for, if you are one of those people, you're going to listen to the form. And in music, when we talk about a form, that basically means the structure of the song. And in this case, it's a 12-bar blues form. Okay, 12-bar blues. There's only two instruments in this song, one being the guitar, which is the most popular instrument in the blues, and then the vocals. So you're gonna have a guitar and a vocal, and both of those will be played by Robert Johnson. And then you're gonna have, which is probably one of the most important elements of the blues, and that is what we call blues notes, okay? So for people who know a little bit about music, blues notes are
they are notes that are produced when someone slides. They slide the note. So instead of singing, you might sing, that's a blues note. That's a slide, right? Those are blues notes, as opposed to being ha 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 ha. You hear the difference? Ha 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 ha. That's not blues notes. Those are not blues notes. This is the blues style. Ha ha ha. So you're going to hear that type of sound in the guitar playing and in the singing. So I want you to listen for that. And here we go. This is Kind-Hearted Woman Blues. Let's listen to it.
Call
All right. So that was Kind-Hearted Woman Blues. And if you were listening, you heard some of those blues notes in the guitar and also in the singing. And that 12-bar blues, and you only heard two instruments. So this is music that is stripped down to its bare essentials. These people were like what people call today griots. They were, you know, people who traveled and played music, and they had to be able to speak to the people directly. So that's why when you hear that music, it has a very stripped down to the basics type of sound. Now we're going to move on to another song that he wrote. This one is called The Crossroad Blues. And I'm going to state the lyrics to you so you can understand where they're coming from in terms of the content. So the lyrics go like this. Went to the crossroads, fell down on my knees. I went to the crossroad, I fell down on my knees. Asked the Lord above, have mercy, now save your poor Bob, if you please. Yeah, standing at the crossroad, tried to flag a ride. Yeah, I tried to flag a ride. Didn't nobody seem to know me, babe. Everybody passed me by. Standing at the crossroad, baby, rising sun going down. Standing at the crossroad, baby, rising sun going down. I believe in my soul now, poor Bob is sinking down. You can run, tell my friend Willie Brown. You can run, tell my friend Willie Brown that I got the crossroad blues this morning, Lord. Babe, I'm sinking down. And I went to the crossroad, mama. I looked east and I looked west. I went to the crossroad, baby. I looked east and I looked west. Lord, I didn't have no sweet woman or well, babe, in my distress. So you can, if you can imagine, these lyrics are really dealing with some level of torment that he was going through. He was at a crossroads, you know, crossroads, four-way stop, same kind of thing. And he's dealing with something that he's asking the Lord to help him with. And those are the kind of lyrics that could speak directly to people. Doesn't matter what they did all week. Doesn't matter how much education they had. Doesn't even matter how much, it doesn't even matter if they knew English that well, which is why this music became so popular around the world and influenced so many people. Overseas as well, because this music was simply stated, straight to the point. Not a lot of flamboyant, you know, hoopla, straight to the core. So now we're going to listen to the song Crossroad Blues, from which I was reading the lyrics. So here we go, Crossroad Blues.
Down. on now. Oh, Bobby, back it down.
Robert Johnson. I also want to mention that he was born on May 8th, 1911, and he died on August the 16th, 1938, just so you get an idea chronologically where he falls in to the jazz age in the, you know, the 20s. Okay, so now we're going to move on to a man by the name of Charlie Patton. Charlie Patton was born on or in April of 1891, and interestingly, he died in April as well, on April 28th, 1934. And Charlie Patton is one of these blues men from the same period. Had a different style, more of a rough, kind of rough-edged, barking kind of style. And you're going to hear it. And his voice was very influential on a whole heap of rock musicians that have this same kind of burly type of approach to their to the way they sing lyrics. And you'll hear, when you hear him, it's not the smooth style like Robert Johnson. One of his popular songs during the time was High Water Everywhere. I'm going to read the lyrics to you. And it goes like this. Well, backwatered and rolls all around Sumner now. Drove me down the line, backwatered and rolls at Sumner. Drove poor Charlie down the line. Lord, I'll tell the world the water done crept through this town. Lord, the whole round country, Lord, river has overflowed. Lord, the whole round country, man, is overflowed. You know, I can't stay here. I'll go where it's high, boy. I will go to the hilly country, but they got me barred. Now, look here, now at Leland, river was rising high. Look here, boys, all around Leland, tell me. River was raising high. Boy, it's rising over there. Yeah, I'm going to move to Greenville before I leave. Goodbye. Look here, the water now, Lordy, levee broke, rose most everywhere. The water at Greenville and Leland, Lord, it done rose everywhere. Boy, you can't never stay here. I will go down to Roseville, but they tell me there's water there. Now, the water now, mama, done took Charlie's town. Well, they tell me the water done took Charlie's town. Boy, I'm going to Vicksburg. Well, I'm going to Vicksburg for that high of mine. I'm going that going up that water where lands don't never flow. Well, I'm going over the hill where water don't ever flow. Boy, hit Sharkey County and everything was down in Stovall. But that whole county was leaving over that Tallahatchie shore. Boy, went to Tallahatchie and got it over there. Lord, the water then rushed all over down old Jackson Road. Lord, the water then raised over the Jackson Road. Boy, it starched my clothes. I'm going back to the hilly country. Won't be worried no more. So apparently there was some flooding, to say the least. There was a lot of flooding, and it made life pretty challenging for the people at this time. So he's writing this song about this this moment. And then also, a lot of these blues lyricists will write using metaphors, right? So the water could be a metaphor for something else. Going up to the hills could be a metaphor for something else. So he might be using
metaphors because he's talking about something that maybe he doesn't want to say on record. So during this time, a lot of that went down in every style, in blues, in jazz music, in musical theater, in Tin Pan Alley songs, because it was a much more conservative society at the time, and they couldn't just sing about things that people sing today because they'd be barred from talking about that subject. So they'd speak in metaphors, using metaphors. And so you could get the message that way, if you knew what he was talking about, right? The water being whatever, you know, wink, wink, it's not the water, it's something else. Could be drinking. Maybe he was drinking, you know, the water was too high, same kind of thing. So we're gonna listen to the original, and like the song with Robert Johnson, this song shares the same song form. And it has a 12-bar blues form, which means that if you counted to 12, if you counted to four 12 times, you'd be back at the top. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 3, 4, 4, 2, 3, 4, et cetera, to 12, 2, 3, 4. Then that's the end of the form. You go back to the beginning. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's a 12-bar form for people who don't play. And then listen to how the guitar is used both as a guitar, but how the back of the guitar is being used as a drum, like a percussion instrument. So you hit, play on the front and then hit it on the back. And then you can create a drum type of sound. And so listen to how that's being used. And also listen to how the second person is speaking in the background and responding to the lead vocal of Charlie Patton. And we call that a call and response, right? And so with that style of singing, you have a more communal approach that regular people can hear and relate to. So you are able to touch people in a different way than if you just kind of talk to them and they just sit and listen the whole time. Okay, so now we're going to listen to High Water Everywhere. Let's check it out. I'm going out that water while let your never flow.
So you could hear how his style was much more rough-edged. And, you know, these guys were living the types of lives that you hear in the music. You hear that hollering and, you know, grunting type of style of singing. You know, those guys were hollering and grunting off of the mic, too. You know what I mean? So this is real, real people music, which is important to note. And this is why this music became so popular, not only here in this country, but also in Europe, and why different rock bands were gravitated towards them, because they could hear that rawness of emotion, and they could identify with it. Especially some of these rock bands, you got to understand, the early rock bands were rebels. You know, they were pushing back against society. So when they heard someone like him, who sounded like he was a rebel as well, they really identified with that. And we're highly influenced by the music. So it's important to understand what kind of personality that some of these people were while they were making their music. And so when you read their lyrics and you listen to their music, and you can hear that realness and how they exuded that realness in the lives they lived. It's very important to note. You have to remember, these people are coming right off of plantations. Most of the blues artists that we're going to talk about that traveled out of the Mississippi Delta up to Chicago, they worked on plantations. So that's a hard type of life, you know. So it's important to know that. Now we're going to listen to a song called Spoonful Blues. It was recorded in 1929 by Charlie Patton as well. And also you want to listen to how they intersperse between singing and spoken word as a way to really communicate with the people. I don't think that they mapped it out, like, we're going to do this and we're going to do that. It's just how the music was, and it just spoke to the people. And also how the guitar has a trotting or walking kind of effect. You'll hear it when you listen to it. So here we go, Spoonful Blues by Charlie Patton.
I'm about to go to jail about this spoonful. Yeah. baby won't quit me.
Yeah, I'm all get better. It's all I want. It's me.
Look at here, baby. I'm leaving town.
Get better.
Bad,
but I want my baby. I'm full of bad, bad.
Look at
you, I need that for giving me little dollar. Don't need me.
I know
that. Baby, I'm around. It ain't got me on.
All right, so that was Charlie Patton. So you hear the difference between he and Robert Johnson. Has a more just a rougher kind of tinge to his music.
And so now we heard the rural blues or country blues, right?
So you hear that sound, that rawness of sound. Now, not everybody could get into that sound, and there was somebody who knew that and was able to take the music and morph it into something that was more palatable for American society, particularly for city people and for the majority, which were Caucasian people.
So this person is W.C. Handy, and he was born in 1873 on November 16th, and he died on March 28th in 1958.
Now, W.C. Handy was a trained musician steeped in Black American and classical music. What he did was translate the blues into a language which was easy to hear, understand, and emulate. He gave America a gift from Black Southern American culture that was much easier to digest than the raw Southern versions of early blues, the blues we just listened to. He demonstrated the deep Southern vocal performances in a more simpler fashion. He is also responsible for transcribing and publishing the true feel of blues vocal styles, but in a way that was easy to understand. Prior to W.C. Handy, no one else captured these expressions, making them available for purchase on manuscript paper for people to purchase throughout America and the world. He is known as the father of the blues, or was known. Now, it's known that he, being from Memphis, he's from Memphis, Tennessee, that he was walking along at night and he heard one of these musicians from the country singing the blues. He heard this style and he liked it, but he also knew that he had to change it up a little bit so that he could make some money off of it, basically. And so he did so. He just made the melody less, having less blues notes. So that whole wah, 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 that whole sound, he took a lot of that out. And also what he did was he made it less country or less Black. So that's just what he did. So by doing so, everybody from different cultures were able to get into the music. Different economic backgrounds, different cultures, different instruments, different styles of music. They could purchase this music and play it, read it right down, play it at a party, play it at a social gathering, and instantly connect with the music. Now, you also have to know that he had a successful publishing company during this time. And he also hired other very, very intelligent and great musicians during that time. And he was one of those people that was a trendsetter. He had a publishing company and he wrote music. So during this time when people were all buying music, he made out very, very well financially. So he was ahead of the game. And that's important to know about W.C. Handy.
Now, we're going to listen to St. Blues and St. Louis Blues. Now, when you hear St. Louis Blues, really check out how different it is from the two previous blues songs that you just heard. You'll probably be able to, well, depending on where you're from musically, you might be able to hear it a lot easier, depending on where you're from. You know, some people might hear it and say, I like the other stuff better. I like, you know, Robert Johnson better. You know, I like Charlie Patton better. But just listen to the way W.C. Handy plays and listen to the classical approach that he brought to the blues and how he influenced blues and played it in his own way. Check this out. Here we go, St. Louis Blues.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Your Lincoln Mercury dealer presents The Toast of the Town, starring the nationally syndicated newspaper columnist, Ed Sullivan.
A great genius arose originally from Alabama, then switched to Memphis, Tennessee. W.C. Handy wrote St. Louis Blues. So let's have a great hand for Mr. Handy, won't you please?
So you can hear it was a much more accessible style of playing the blues. And he also extended the form. It wasn't just a 12-bar blues that he was playing. He actually added different sections to the song form because he was a more trained musician. He was somebody that could play written music, you know, music that was written down, the notes, the actual dots on the page. He could do all that. The other gentleman that we talked about, Robert Johnson and Charlie Patton, they did not read music. They did not come from that type of background. So you can see the difference in the way that these musicians, he was different from the other two musicians. He was an educated musician, and he knew different styles, and he also knew the business of music and was able to make a lot of money producing sheet music and selling it. Where the other guys, they weren't those types of music artists. So, want to give W.C. Handy his props for being able to develop his business side and how he was able to really bring that sound to the masses. Definitely want to give him respect for that. Now we're going to move on to a different style of music. It is called ragtime music. And probably the most popular ragtime musician was Scott Joplin, whom I'm sure you've heard of his some of his songs, because they're almost like a big part of American culture at this point. You'll hear his music in movies, etc., and you'll also hear the influence of his music on other music. Now, Scott Joplin was born on November 24th, 1868 in Northeast Texas, and then he died on April 1st, 1917 in New York City. And now let's talk about ragtime. Ragtime is another style which preceded jazz. Ragtime is piano-based music which arose out of Missouri. The music features a steady bass line in the left hand while a syncopated melody is played in the right hand. Ragtime's most prolific composer, as I said, is Scott Joplin. He eventually sold over 1 million copies of sheet music of ragtime's most well-known composition, which was the Maple Leaf Rag. So this is somebody who was getting a piece of the publishing of his music that was sold, each sheet, piece of sheet music. So he did very well for himself. He negotiated a good royalty with his publisher. The publisher is the person who prints up the music and gets it in the stores. And he said, hey, I want a nice, you know, pretty cut of the money, percentages, every time one is sold. And he got it, and he did very well for himself. He received a lot of criticism, particularly from Caucasian critics. The critics were so negative that in 1908, Scott Joplin wrote a book which explained and broke down the complexities of ragtime for students of the music. It was called The School of Ragtime. And that was his way of saying, look, what you're saying about the music is not true, that you're saying that it's this and it's that. Let me break it down. Let me explain to you what I'm doing in the music. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. Over on this page, I'm doing this. In this section, from bars 2 to 8, I'm doing this. So he was able to really break it down and say, this is what I'm doing with the music. And through that, he was able to sell his book to students, as I said before, who are going, what is that? What is he doing, man? He's just playing, and you know, he's doing one thing in the left hand, another thing in the right hand. What is he doing? So he's one of the first musicians that broke it down, really explained it. This is what I'm doing. That was good for the time, because at that time, not a lot of blacks were doing that. They were not writing about their music. They were not selling their own sheet music. But these two gentlemen in particular, Scott Joplin and W.C. Handy, were. So they should be heralded for doing so during that time. And so that's Scott Joplin and ragtime music. Now we're going to move on to jazz, which is in an extension of ragtime. Okay? So you say, well, what is jazz? What is jazz? Okay, well, there are six elements of jazz that are very important to know and to understand. Now, in one way, I'll say jazz improvisation is the process of spontaneously creating fresh melodies over the continuously repeating cycle of chord changes of a tune. The improviser, or the person that's making up ideas on the spot, may depend on the contours of the original tune or solely on the possibilities of the chord's harmonies. So they'll rely on the chord structure, song structure, And then they will add things as it repeats. And they will add things as they want to in the music. And those ideas end up being reflective of their personality. And that's why most jazz musicians sound different from each other. They have a set of ideas that help them express what they feel in the music. And so hopefully, at least we could talk about the past jazz musicians, you would have musicians that did not sound alike. This musician sounded different from that one was different from that one, and they had their own style. Now you have people who followed someone else's style, but I'm talking about the progenitors of the music, the people who we call masters of jazz. Those people had their own way of playing and improvising. And like I said, improvising is when you make up ideas on the spot. Some of you might study acting, or you might know of different actors or comedians. They also use improvisation as a way to express themselves. And that's basically, you have, like, say, on Saturday Night Live, you might have a different skit. And within the skit, they have a shell of what it's going to be about, but then sometimes they improvise. Actually, you know, Mad TV did that more than Saturday Night Live, but Mad TV did it quite a bit. And you just basically have, like, this is a theme, and then we're going to make up ideas based off of it. You had that also happen with people like Rodney Dangerfield. You just improvise. You react to the joke, and then he'd extend it more and take the story on a whole journey. That's what jazz improvisation does, but it does it with notes, with saxophones, trumpets, pianos, and song structure. So that's the difference. Now you have these six elements. Rhythmically, it's a syncopated music, okay? Swing rhythms, which come from West Africa, are also a part of it, particularly a rhythm called dum dum ba, which is a sound or a rhythm that goes dum 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 dum. Dun, 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 dun. That rhythm is what drummers play on the ride cymbal. When you go hear a jazz group and they say, that's dun dun ba. Okay? Not a lot of people know that, but I went through some music and really dissected it. But that rhythm is a West African rhythm called dun dun ba. So you have syncopated rhythms, most of which the syncopated aspect, that's an African part of the music. Now you have European chords and song structures, okay? So the chord progressions, that comes from Europe. Okay, so you're talking about chords.
You know, you have, say, eight bars, and you have a group of chords that make up what we call a harmony or harmonic content, that is from Europe in terms of the chord structures, major, minor, you know, and how they're used in succession, and also the piano, which is a European instrument. Then you have blues notes or bent notes. That's from the deep south of the United States.
That's from black musicians, particularly ones that worked in the fields.
And then you have a call and response element in the music. And that comes from, a lot of that comes from church and also working in the fields, right? So, you know, you have people say, you know, they might say, when I was working last night, and somebody say, what you say? Or you say, when I was working yesterday, or everything went great. My life was great.
And they might respond to the singer and say that. Or they might say, I'm not going back no more. Mm-hmm. Na 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 na. Response is, mm-hmm. The call is, na 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 na. Mm-hmm. Na 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 na. Mm-hmm.
That's a call and response, all right? And then you have emotions which are expressed through the music, such as pain, joy, and freedom. And these expressions are directly related to the unfair treatment that black Americans experience while living in a segregated and racially hostile society.
Everybody experiences pain and joy, but the type of pain and joy I'm talking about is just a certain type of pain and joy that happened in America. And freedom, you know, attaining freedom, you know, all that is in the music. And so you have five elements, sorry. Those are the five elements, not six elements. Five elements. You should know those. So run it back if you have to in order to memorize those. All right, when was the jazz age? Okay, this is important, so take notes. The jazz age is the name given to the era in American history between the end of World War I, which is around 1918, and the start of the Great Depression, which was in 1929. The jazz age is also referred to in conjunction with the Roaring Twenties. The jazz age was a period of many political, economic, and social changes when Americans cast aside old social conventions in favor of new ideas. Embracing the rapid cultural and social changes of modernism and the flamboyant lifestyles of the new era. So that is what the jazz, or when the jazz age was. You say, well, why was it called the jazz age? The jazz age was the term coined by F. Scott Fitzgerald, the writer that I showed you in the beginning, to describe the flamboyant anything goes era that was a feature of the 1920s. Jazz music characterized by improvisation, talked about that, syncopation, right, we talked about that, and a lively, strong rhythm was introduced during the Harlem Renaissance, the African-American artistic and literary movement. I mentioned that as well, the Harlem Renaissance. Jazz music somehow typified the nonconformist aspirations of youth that dominated the shocking new fashions and lifestyles that emerged during the 1920s jazz age. Okay? So that's important to know. You say, where was the jazz age? Where was it? Was it on the West Coast? Was it in, where was it, right? The jazz age influenced the world, but its roots were in New York City, Chicago, and New Orleans. Of course, other cities in America were also influenced by the jazz age, but these were the main cities where the music, the fashion, and the dancing were on the rise, right? So you had, you know, people traveling around the country, but most of the growth artistically, intellectually, was happening in these cities, musically, and they would bring the music out. They even brought it to LA. There are places here where, you know, people like Louis Armstrong played right over in Culver City. Matter of fact, there was a Harlem, there was a Cotton Club. The Cotton Club is the club that was popular in Harlem. There was a club, there was a West Coast Cotton Club in Culver City. And so the musicians like Duke Ellington, Louis Armstrong, Cab Calloway, they would leave New York and come out to LA to perform in LA. Right over in Culver City, but the difference was this is not where the music started. It started in New York, St. Louis, Chicago, New Orleans, and then they brought it out here. And the dancing as well. The dancing was brought out as well as the music, and that's how these styles traveled around the country. Because you have to remember at the time, TV was not popular. You know, and the radio was just starting, the technology for radio broadcasting was just starting. So musicians traveled, dancers traveled, they had vaudeville acts, they had great big bands performing, and people would go out and dance, and they'd see, oh, that's the new dance, or that's, oh, look at that suit, that's a zoot suit, what is that? Never seen that before. Wow, okay, that's the new thing to do, and then people would catch on. Where today, it's a whole different thing. Today, it's just like you just go on the internet or flick on the TV and you can kind of catch up with what people are doing stylistically, you know, in terms of song, dance, speech, you know, the way they dress, or you can get a magazine, you can check it out. A little different back then, not a little, a lot different. They depended on entertainers to travel and bring the music and the fashions and everything to these other cities from New York City, Chicago, and New Orleans. And I can even mention St. Louis, which I did, because they had their own music going on there. Okay, so that wraps up the first session of Key Movements, The Age of Jazz. I gave you some great information that you will need to know and to become familiar with. For the people who are taking this class for the first time, I encourage you to take notes based off of what I just talked about, and then you want to use that information for when you're testing, and you want to study with that information. Okay, so I'm letting you know now, because there are going to be some people going to say, "Well, hey, what do we use to study? Study your notes. Take notes off of everything I'm talking about and use that, and it'll help guide you and give you information for when it's time to take your test. You can study them and you can know exactly what's going on, but go through the video with that in mind. Write down what's going on and you'll be fine. Okay, and at this point, I encourage you to visit the website of Dominguez Hills, CSUDH. This is where I teach music here under the direction of our department chair, Scott Morris, Dr. Scott Morris. He's doing great things here at CSUDH, really growing the program and bringing new ideas to the program that haven't been seen before. So if you're interested in studying music, please reach out to us, visit us on our website, send an email, gather information, and use it to your advantage. We are willing to, we're hoping that you reach out to us, to study music. And then also, when you get a chance, visit my website. My website is www.teodrosavery.com. Again, www.teodrosavery.com, and you can find out about me, what I do, different projects I've done, what I've done in the past, and also future projects as well. And that's pretty much about it. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you on the next one. All right. Peace out. Bye-bye.